Hello, Summoners, and welcome to another Pro Guides video. I'm Tia, and today we'll be talking about how to master the art of the teamfight. A lot of our videos cover the strongest picks in the meta, but getting fed isn't always enough to win the games alone. So hit that sub button and let's fight. There's a lot that goes into this, so we'll try to divide things up. First, loosely talking about different styles of team fighting, and then looking more at things like individual roles in a team fight. As a little disclaimer, I do want to say that a lot of this information is generalized, and every game of League has its nuances. Even with the exact same team comp on both sides, there's always going to be factors like which champs are strong, what the state of the game is looking like, and what positioning is like for both sides that can completely call for different team fighting strategies. But before we get into all of that, here's today's question of the day. What removed or reworked item would you like added back to League? Honestly, I'm taking it way back because I just miss the mana potions. Come on, I just want to freely spam abilities in the bot lane as a support. But that's enough about me. I want to know what you guys think. Let me know in the comments down below. So anyways, back on topic, let's talk about the basic styles of teamfighting. The first and most common teamfighting strat is front to back. This is the most basic form of teamfighting and is easy to execute even in solo queue. The style of teamfighting is best for comps with a tanky frontline to engage and peel, and with the ideal damage dealers being control mages and marksmen that can put out the consistent DPS needed to burn through the enemy frontliners before your own frontline is brought down. An example of this would be something like Malphite top, Jarvan jungle, Orianna in the mid lane, Vayne ADC, and Lulu support. This one is pretty self-explanatory, but when front-to-back fighting, the general goal is to just take down the enemy targets one at a time, starting with their tanks rather than diving onto the carries in the back line. As I said before, this type of fighting relies on your DPS bringing down the enemy frontliners first. Let's take our example comp of Malphite, Jarvan, Ori, Vayne, and Lulu, and pit it against something like Ornn, Olaf, Annie, Jhin, and Janna. If both teams try to front to back, the carries on the first team, especially Vayne, do a much better job of shredding through the frontline than the carries on the other team. Malphite should look to engage the fight, and Jarvan should look to disrupt any threats trying to reach his backline. A good J4 ult is one of the only ways to peel an Olaf, since he's immune to actual CC. Ori and Vayne can tear through the frontline with Ori ult and Lulu helping to deal with anyone that tries to dive past the frontline. The one way front-to-back comps fall apart is when the frontliners have bad target selection and forget their role in a fight. After the initial engage, Malph and Jarvan need to keep focus on being a wall between any enemy threats and their backline. Chasing after kills will just leave their carries open to being taken out. The second style of team fighting is diving. Diving is the exact opposite of the front-to-back style of team fighting, and as the name implies, involves getting past the enemy frontline and taking out their carries fast. The comps that rely on diving generally have 3 or 4 damage threats, meaning they don't have the durability to win the extended, drawn-out fight that front-to-back comps do with their tanky frontline. The best champs for fighting by diving are the ones that can consistently reach the backline, isolate their target, and are pretty hard to peel. Some examples are Camille, Hecarim, Nocturne, and Vi. While you won't often draft an entire team comp of 5 diving champs, it definitely helps to have 2 or 3 champs that can synergize with this goal in mind. For example, pairing any of the above champs with Galio means they can dive into the enemy comp, lock down their target, and give Galio a perfectly placed ult that forces all 4 other members of the enemy team to scatter and leave their teammate to die. A couple of other champs that go well with divers are Shen and Kai'Sa, who can piggyback on their teammates' engage and help them bring down their targets. Champs like Zac and Malphite can be huge assets when diving, but since they're mostly about huge amounts of CC, they'll be engaging to set up the other divers to actually kill the targets. This team fighting style works by basically abandoning any of your non-diving backliners, leaving them to fend for themselves, while you burst down a squishy target or two in the enemy backline and give your team a numbers advantage in the fight. Aside from Kai'Sa and Tristana, most ADCs don't really have the tools to jump super far into fights. Since they'll generally be left to the wolves without much frontline to peel for them, the best ADCs for this are the self-sufficient ones that have mobility to try and kite threats that try to jump on them, like Ezreal and Lucian. Just keep in mind that even when you have a champ that generally dives, that doesn't mean you should always look into that playstyle. If the enemy ADC is Xayah, for example, whose ult can protect her from pretty much any threat in the game, then fully committing to diving on her will usually result in her just dodging your engage and blowing you up instead. We have even more stuff to go over in this video, but I just wanted to take a second to say that if you want to know even more info on teamfighting or any other fundamental concept of League, maybe you should really consider picking up a Pro Guide subscription. With it, you can get access to all of our courses, unlimited chats with our top-tier coaches, and if you decide to book a session with one, you'll get a discounted rate. And there's no better time to sign up than now, because we're running a great deal till the end of the month. Use discount code RANKUP2021 for 20% off your subscription. The last team fighting style we'll look at is kiting. It's definitely not an optimal playstyle, but sometimes you just have to work with what you have. The times you'll use this comp are those when your team doesn't draft any engage, or when you have engaged, but you just don't win the DPS race against the enemy team in a straight 5v5. This one can be difficult to pull off, especially if the opposing team has hard engage, but like I said, you'll just have to make do. For an example of this, we'll say your comp is Tryndamere top, Gragas jungle, Anivia mid, Ezreal ADC, and Yuumi support. The enemy comp has Maokai top, Olaf jungle, Seraphine mid, Vayne ADC, and a Thresh support. Even with a huge lead, you'd find it hard to win a head-to-head fight against this team, but you also don't really have the ability to dive and kill their backline with your champs. More likely than not, the plan for this game would be for Trin to split push while the rest of you hold down the rest of the map. Before a fight even breaks out, you'll want Ezreal to land as much poke as he can from a safe range. If Maokai gives up on matching Trin and meets with his team to try and force a fight, you have plenty of disengage with Gragas and Yuumi ults. Even with Olaf being immune to CC, Anivia wall can stop him from reaching your team. The idea here is to poke them out and kite them until you've gotten them so low that they can't even take the 4v5 anymore. All the while, Tryndamere is split pushing his way to victory on the other side of the map. Since you won't be able to win standard fights, vision control is a huge factor in how the game turns out. If your team controls the vision around Baron or Dragon, you get to poke out your opponents anytime they try to come and establish vision for themselves. But if you let your opponents get control of the area first, you have to face check and risk being blown up to get any vision in the area. Because of this vision control aspect, these comps that rely on kiting alone to win are nearly impossible to play from behind, since you'll never be able to contest the neutral areas of the map. Now that we've looked at the three basic styles of teamfighting, let's take a look at some of the more specific roles you may have in a teamfight, and in some cases, why it may be worth foregoing that role for a different one. The first role we have is DPS. For the sake of this video, we're using DPS to refer to champs that do high DPS over time, not as a blanket term for damage dealers in general. When you're playing a DPS champ like Azir, Vayne, or Jinx, your number one goal is maximizing your survivability while dealing as much damage as possible. That means you shouldn't be flashing in to trade your life to take out one opponent. You'll pretty much always be hitting the target closest to you and staying close to your support and allies that can peel for you. We already had a section on the diving style of team fighters, but let's revisit it. When you're playing to dive the enemy back line, remember, your goal is to blow up your target before your own carries are killed. Keep in mind that doing this can often end in you trading your own life for the kill, especially if you're diving in as a squishy champ, but that can easily be worth it if the champ you're taking down is the primary carry for the enemy team. Some divers like Hecarim or Camille can start a fight with their ults, but others, namely assassins like Zed, Kha'Zix, and Katarina, may have to wait a bit at the start of the fight, looking for an opening to jump on the back line. Burst mages can fall into this category too, since someone like Annie or Syndra can easily flash into the enemy backline and delete a carry. But be sure that you can 100% bring down that target, since you lack the mobility to get out after the job is done. With that in mind, there are some factors that can change whether it's worth investing so much in killing that target. The first is whether you can even kill that champ in the first place. Like we said earlier, if you're a Nocturne or Hecarim diving onto a Xayah, there's probably not much of a chance you're going to kill her. She's just gonna ult your ult, and between her follow-up E and her whole team working to peel you, you'll just get shredded. Other times, the carries may have too much survivability from their items and their teammates peeling and protecting them. There are also times where you may be able to kill your target, but there are simply better options for target selection. Let's use this example. You're doing okay as Lee Sin, and you have a really fed Jinx on your team. The enemy Olaf is pretty fed, while their ADC is a 0 and 7 Lucian. A lot of players may be tempted to just dive into the enemy backline and try to insect Lucian into their team. But the play here is to do everything you can to keep Jinx safe. Even though Olaf can't be CC'd, your damage helps to bring him down faster, especially if you Black Cleaver to let Jinx rip through him even faster. Now that we've talked about the two primary damage-dealing roles, let's look at some of the other roles that help facilitate the carries. I'd like to note that in a lot of cases, you'll definitely see some overlap between these categories. For our first role in this section, we have Initiators. The champs in this role are the ones that can force a fight to happen with the press of a button. Champs like Ornn, Malphite, and Leona can check off this box when building a team comp. Their ability to pretty much instantly engage fights are why they are always at least decent, if not obscenely OP, in almost every meta. While you don't need crazy mechanics to play these champs, it's more about picking and choosing the right targets at the right times. You don't always need to hit multiple targets, but you probably shouldn't be wasting all of your engage on a feeding Yasuo. Look for priority targets, especially those with their flash down, and force on them if they ever put themselves in a bad spot. You'll also want to be sure your teammates are in range when you go in. What seems like a perfect 5-man ult isn't so perfect if there's no one close enough to follow up. The next role we'll talk about are the Disruptors. These champs are the ones that do everything they can to stop the opponents from playing the game their way. Most champs in this category are tanks, like Leona and Maokai, who have a lot of CC on very short cooldowns, but there are other examples too. Malphite specifically disrupts auto attacks with his massive attack speed slow. Some enchanters fit in here too. Janna's Q and ult give her ways to stop dashes, making her a huge pick for countering champs like Lee and Zac. Lulu comes with two slows and a knockup to peel for her carries, and when that's not enough, her polymorph can completely shut down even the most fed divers. While most enchanters will almost always be using their disruption to peel for carries and themselves in the back line, tankier disruptors are a bit more flexible. You'll see Thresh players going for a catch on the enemy backline just as often as you'll see them peeling. The last general category we have for enablers are the healing and shielding champs. Like the DPS champs we talked about earlier, your main goal is to live as long as you can. The longer you're alive, the more healing you'll do, and the more useful you'll be. That said, you don't want to AFK at the back of the fight. The positioning will, of course, vary from champ to champ, since someone like Janna may need a move up to peel. Soraka has to try to land Qs to get full effect from her heals, and Lulu just has to stick with her carry. Just do your best to keep yourself and your team alive as long as possible, without taking any unnecessary risks. A key skill for climbing with these types of champs is recognizing when you can't make the difference in a fight and choosing to not go down with your teammate after they're the ones making a mistake and putting themselves in a bad spot. And that about wraps things up for our team fighting guide. If you enjoyed, be sure to sub to the channel and let us know which removed item you want back in the game down in the comments below. Let's just get mana pots back. But don't forget to check out our Discord in the description box. I can't wait to see you guys back for the next video. But until then, good luck on the Rift. Stay safe and wash those hands before you punch somebody.